Gatuga, I met the same. People who are monetizing their talent, people who are earning money on the digital space. And I have been to many parts of Kenya and witnessed many young people in Kenya who today, courtesy of our ICT hubs, they are monetizing their talent, they are working online, some of them are students. In fact, very interestingly, I went to one school in one college somewhere in Nandi, and I met a gentleman called Brian. And Brian told me, you know, Mr. President, I work for an AI company in Germany. Mind you, Brian has never been to Nairobi. And he doesn't even have a passport. But he works for an AI company in Germany. He makes money. In fact, in that school, the principal told me, we are beginning to have a problem here in this school because some of these students, they earn more than the teachers. So, on the digital space, we are working round the clock. And I have told members of parliament, they need, and I want to ask citizens to demand from our members of parliament that the program we have on ICT hubs, there should be an ICT hub in every ward. We can connect millions of young people to jobs on the digital space, to e-commerce on the digital space, because what government is going to do, members of parliament are going to build the ICT hubs, the government of Kenya is going to deliver internet, the government of Kenya is going to deliver trainers, we are going to deliver computers. It is up to the young people of Kenya to monetize their knowledge, their talent, their expertise, and grow their incomes. That is program number two that is going on as I talk to you. We have already distributed 16,000 computers to all our TVETs in Kenya today, not tomorrow. And there are 120,000, mark that number, 120,000 young people in our TVETs who today are earning on the digital platform because of our training and because of what we have done in that digital space. Number three. What are we doing? You ask me, what are we doing to create jobs? Number three, we have a big program with the Ministry of Labor. In fact, I was today with my principal secretary for labor, Shadrach Madime. I don't know whether he's anywhere in this auditorium, he's somewhere else. Shadrach Madime was with me today. I have changed the management of NEA, National Employment Authority, so that we can tap into opportunities to work outside Kenya. What are we doing in that space? I have negotiated many opportunities. Many people have been asking me, Mr. President, why are you traveling? Yeah? And I want to use this opportunity to answer them. I have been traveling to make sure that I connect Kenyans to jobs, both in country and outside country. We are signing 19 bilateral labor agreements with different countries. In fact, we just concluded one with Germany. So that what happens? So that some of our talented young people, because this is what other countries like Philippines have done. When you have good quality labor, you can use it to drive our economy. In fact, remittances from Kenyans, very hardworking Kenyans outside Kenya, is all the way to about $4 billion. So that is the space we want to use because Kenyans have good education, they speak good English, they are self-motivated, they need less supervision. Any company anywhere in the world will want to hire a Kenyan. And therefore, we must use it because it is the asset that we have. And that is what I have been doing to try and connect Kenyans to jobs outside Kenya. I said today, for example, that those opportunities are available. In fact, if you go to the Ministry of Labor website, there are approximately 400,000 jobs, as I talk to you today. Different types of jobs. And that's why I was saying today, some of those jobs, like the ones for nurses, for example. I was in Saudi Arabia the other day. They want 2,500 nurses. We are unable to meet that quota. And Saudi Arabia pays even for tickets. You don't have to pay any ticket. You just need to be qualified. And there are other countries we are negotiating so that we can get opportunities for Kenyans to work, not just in Kenya, but outside Kenya. Number four, you ask me, what am I doing to create jobs? Number four, we must begin to manufacture things, products that can be manufactured in Kenya instead of importing everything from everywhere. There was a time we were importing toothpicks, imagine. Yeah? And there are people who want to tell us we must continue importing things and products. I made a decision that anything that we have the manufacturing capacity in Kenya, any product that we have manufacturing capacity in Kenya, we must begin to apply duty so that we stop products from other countries and build our own manufacturing capacity, hire our own young people, use our own raw materials, build our own wealth. And let me give you an example. Last year, we imposed duty on steel billets, on cement, on clinker, and on furniture. There was a bit of noise last year because I put down my foot and I said, look, if we have manufacturing capacity in Kenya, somebody explain to me why we continue to import these products. Do you know what happened? Because we put duty on those products, steel, for example, steel billets, 11 companies that had closed down because we had opened the door for importing of steel billets, 11 companies today, hiring 16,000 Kenyans, have opened. And they are now hiring Kenyans and producing steel billets locally in Kenya. You know what's interesting? The same people who were complaining last year, I met them this year. And they told me, Mr. President, you see, that duty you imposed on that product last year, I told them, why don't you reduce it from 17% to 10%? They told me, no, keep it at 17%. Why? Because they had now invested in Kenya. They were producing those products locally. And do you know what? We saved 100 billion shillings of foreign exchange because of stopping to import steel billets. These are statistics that are out there, right? So it is partly why our dollar situation is stabilizing, because we have stopped importing things, products that we can manufacture locally. 11 companies that had closed down, steel companies have opened, they are hiring Kenyans, they are using our local products. Do you know what? I was in Taita Taveta today, and one of the things I'm going to do next month is to go to Taita Taveta, where we have iron ore, which we have been exporting as a raw material. And many people were telling us stories. Now, the same companies who were complaining to me last year, they have said one of them is now going to invest in Taita Taveta iron ore, not to export, but to manufacture steel locally using raw materials from Taita Taveta County, including all the other counties where we have iron ore. That is the difference we make when we make the right decision. So we are building our own local manufacturing capacity. And what are we doing in that space additionally? We are making sure that we support local manufacture. It is the same reason why we said diapers, bumpers. We have 10 companies that are manufacturing these products in Kenya. Explain to me, somebody, why we should continue to import these products from other countries. Explain to me why we continue to export our jobs. We have cotton which we are growing in Kenya. We have nowhere to sell our cotton. We cannot use it to produce our own products because we are importing everything. And that's why I said this year, God willing, we want to make sure that we build our own local capacity. Industrialization, manufacturing, value addition is the way for us to go so that we can create more jobs, create more wealth, and grow our economy. So we are not only expanding our manufacturing capacity, we are stopping unnecessary imports of products that we can manufacture locally so that we can expand our products, our manufacturing. And thirdly, on that space of creating jobs, we now have 6 new special economic zones. In fact, export promotion zones in Kenya. So that product is, that space is going on. And one of the products that, one of the areas we are going to deal with is right here in Mombasa in Dongokundu. I just announced that we now have a partnership with Afriexim Bank to unlock the first 500 acres of Dongokundu for industrial productivity. So we have, I have given you 5. I have told you number 1, our housing program is creating jobs. Number 2, our digital space is creating jobs. Number 3, our export of labor is creating jobs. Number 4, our manufacturing is creating jobs. Number 5, our special economic zones is creating jobs. That is what I'm doing for Kenya. I know you have asked me something else about education. Let me take 1 or 2 questions and then I will consolidate and answer your question on education and on drug abuse. Yes, can I have a lady this time? Oh yeah, that gentleman. Yes, my good friend.
Mimi ni Josh Onsare, mwanabari wa TV 47 na vile vile Radio 47. Kuna haya masuala ambayo yamejitokeza hivi majuzi na nakumbuka kwamba wewe Mheshimiwa Rais ulisema kwamba unabuni serikali ambayo ni broad based. Na tumeza kuona katika baraza jipya la mawaziri wale ambao wameteuliwa, umeweza kuwateua wale viongozi kutoka upinzani. Labda swali ambalo ningependa kujua, je, hii ni mbinu ya kumaliza upinzani? Na je, watatekeleza the plan ambayo wamekuwa kipinga ambayo ulikuwa unaizungumzia wakati wa kampeni kwenda mbele? Asante.
Thank you very much. Broad-based government. I think that's your big question. Let me say this. Because of the challenges and the issues that came up in the last couple of weeks, going into 1 month, I committed to the country that I am going to form a broad-based government. And many people are asking me to explain, as on Saturday I'm saying, what is this broad-based government? It is broad-based government. That's what it is. It is what it is. Because, you know, because, you know, there has been this feeling that maybe this government is made of William Ruto's friends, right? And William Ruto's buddies. And I said, it is time. You know, I have friends. And I've seen many people ask me, okay, why did you, you know, dismiss the whole cabinet? And then you hired some back. Let me answer it this way. It was necessary to have a fresh start. Because as I told the people of Kenya, we're going to have a broad-based government and we're going to have a fresh start. So that even those I have given another opportunity to serve in cabinet, they must now know that this is new. The terms are different. We may have been friends, but now the terms are different. Number 2, I also wanted other people to join in government because for a long time as Kenyans, we've been divided on sides. And that's why I decided this time around, let me form an administration that has the broader face of Kenya. And that is why you see some of the members of my new cabinet coming from different formations, political formations. And I said I'm going to consult. And I'm going to talk to people who are willing to talk to me. There are those who did not want to talk to me, and that's fine. That's democracy. There are those whom we sat down and we agreed with, and we agreed on their agenda. What are we going to do? In fact, at some point, I was having a conversation, and the conversation went like, okay, the housing program. The housing program was in the manifesto of ODM and was in the manifesto of Kenya Kwanza. True? They're all there. The UHC program, it was on both sides of the divide. There are things that are common between us. And my question is, those things that we have no contest about, can we agree on those things and move the country forward on the things that are not in contention between the sides? And that is how we agreed with ODM to work on the broad-based government that captures some of the items that we all agree on. Number two, let me clarify, as the party leader of ODM did, that we did not form a coalition government so that nobody should tell us we're trying to compromise the opposition. We did not form, we have no formal coalition arrangement. What we have is running an administration on matters that we have agreed, members of ODM who have agreed to come and work with us so that we can put the country first and be able to deal with the challenges that brings Kenya to where it is, whether it is our housing plan, whether it is matters to do with UHC, and all the other items that we agree on as a nation are important to the people of Kenya. I am not very keen on who takes the credit. I am keen on the transformation of Kenya. So this is what I can tell you about that arrangement. Okay, we have yes, there is a lady there.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kadra Hussein from More Radio. Mr. President, allow me to just ask a follow-up question on what my colleague has asked. You say that you consulted from different political formation. From what we have as a people, the people who are on the streets did not have T-shirts printed with political parties, you know, identification. Neither did they carry banners that had colors of representation of a political party. So in your broad-based government, as you have said, you've consulted and you've also had people from ODM working with you. Where is the interest of the people being featured in your broad-based government, as they are the ones who prompted us to have this change that we are having right now? Now, to my question, I want us to just take time back, you know, from the inception of the Kenya Kwanza government. When you took the oath of office, you promised to protect the Constitution of Kenya and ensure that the justice system functions well. You protect the rule of law. When you were making your statement on Wednesday, if I'm not wrong, you told us about amendments of some few clauses of the Constitution, including Public Finance Management Act. You also talked about witness, something to do with that. That is an act of in the Constitution of Kenya. But the populace has this question. Why would we talk about amendments? Why? Those very clauses that we have in the Constitution are not being respected. Like, I'll give you an example. Extrajudicial killings that we have seen, not unless, you know, we can be given files of crime for the people who died. And then also on that, we had arbitrary arrests. We also have forced disappearances, not unless also the government can explain to the people where these people are, or maybe if you have the information on that. Also, other things is that media rights and freedom, from media censorship and also being granted the opportunity to have the information needed to be given to the public. Also, another issue which I'll just say is on the commission and independent offices like KNCHR, that is the Kenya National Commission for Human Rights, which you can be publicly held to account when you said about the numbers of people who died. And also we have IPOA, where they've been talking about frustrations in getting information that is necessary to prosecute some of the officers who had gone rogue during the protest. That is just an example I'm giving you about the constitution. And also something else on leadership and integrity, whereby even one nominated person among those whom you've nominated in your cabinet is actually facing graft case in the ESCC currently as we speak. And you talked about Singapore on development. Just a reminder, Mr. President, that in Singapore, they have extreme, serious penalties when it comes to matters of corruption. Same as Indonesia, that just shows you how grave economic crimes are, especially matters of corruption. So I want to ask you, Mr. President, you've told the Kenyans to give you timeline, actually to give you time to work on these issues, to set things right. If we are to hold you responsible today, Mr. President, what is the way forward from now on, seeing that there is the respect of the rule of law, the very constitution that you sought to protect, and also in the event that these timelines expire, the ones you've given us, 6 months, 9 months, 3 months, 30 days, if they expire and we see no change, would you wait for the youth to start pushing for you to, you know, out of government? And also, would you heed to the pressure that right now we are actually seeing 14 Kenyans have moved to the courts actually asking for the ouster of you, Mr. President? Mm-hmm. What do you have to say about that?
Thank you very much. The 14 Kenyans who have gone to court are exercising their democratic right. That is how free this country is. That you can actually go to any court and demand whatever you want in court. That is the taste of the freedom that I stand for in Kenya. And I want to promise you that those Kenyans who have gone to court for whatever reason, they are free to do it, and the courts are free to make whatever decision that is constitutional. You have asked me, I think, 10 questions. Let me try and answer some of them. Number one, you have asked me, the people who went to the streets, they did not carry the color of any political party. That is correct. But remember, they carried the flag of Kenya. And that is why I'm saying, let us put the interest of the people of Kenya first. That is why I'm saying this broad-based government must be a government that must do, at the very least, three things. And I stated them in my address to the nation. Number one is the subject of integrity, which you have spoken very clearly about, dealing with the challenge of corruption. I have made very specific interventions. I have suggested very specific interventions on how to deal with the challenge of corruption. I have said we must change the Evidence Act so that corruption cases doesn't take 5-10 years. That is what happens today, that we should be able to conclude corruption cases in 6 months. I will be making the proposal to Parliament. I hope Parliament agrees with me so that we can deal with the challenge and monster of corruption firmly and decisively. Number two, I have given my undertaking to the judiciary. In fact, I had an engagement with the Chief Justice a few days ago on my administration's support for the judiciary. It is demonstrable. When I came into office, I made sure that the judiciary has sufficient resources to be able to discharge their mandate, to be able to deal with corruption cases, to be able to deal with all the other cases. In fact, I am the president that has sworn in the highest number of judges in the shortest time in Kenya. To facilitate the judiciary to be able to discharge their mandate. Because it is said, justice denied is justice. Justice delayed is justice denied. And you can ask from members of the judiciary my support for the judiciary. In fact, when I came into office, there were six judges that have been denied their right to be appointed. I appointed them the first day when I got into office to demonstrate my commitment to the judiciary. Let me also say the following, that on the subject of corruption, I am very clear in my mind, and I will mobilize resources that are available. I will mobilize every resource that is available to deal with the challenge of corruption. Number two, I also said this new administration must deal with the issue of making sure that we create jobs in Kenya by making sure that we don't import the things that we can manufacture in Kenya. Number three, I said this new administration I'm setting up must deal with the challenge of making sure that tax expenditure, we spend 400 billion shillings every year of taxpayers' money paying companies, paying institutions, claiming tax refunds, claiming VAT refunds in a process that is not thoroughly clear. And I have said that going forward, we have to deal with this problem. So I have laid out a clear roadmap on what the administration I've just appointed must achieve. I know you have said we must respect the Constitution, which we must. And I gave my undertaking to the country that there will be no disappearance of Kenyans. I gave that undertaking. There will be no Kenyans in Rivayala. There will be no Kenyans in Tana River. There was a time we had 30-something bodies of Kenyans in rivers. That will never happen under my watch. And I have said this with clarity. If there is any Kenyan who has disappeared, I want people to step forward and say, Kenyan so-and-so has disappeared. I would be very happy to deal with it. Because under my administration, I have said there will be no disappearance of Kenyans again. There will be no extrajudicial killing of Kenyans. I have said that with clarity. And let me also say the following, that as we go forward, we must be truthful. When the Kenya National Human Rights stepped forward with fake news and said 200 Kenyans had been massacred in Githurai, it was a flat lie. I mean, surely. I mean, a whole institution that is supposed to be self-respecting, paid for by the government of Kenya, how can they go and tell the country that 200 Kenyans had been killed, which was utter, you know, falsehood, you know? I hope that's not the organization you want to defend, you know? You cannot defend an organization that runs on fake news. And I will call them out, as Kenyans should call them out. We must stick to what is true. 42 Kenyans died, very unfortunately, in the events of the last 1 month. They shouldn't have died. Some of them in situations where the police were involved. Some of them in situations where criminals were involved. Some of them in different situations. All those situations are under investigations. And I have given undertaking that the government of Kenya will support those families even as we get to the bottom of what happened in those situations. I have also undertaken that there are Kenyans who unfortunately lost property. We are also going to support them because it was nothing of their doing that occasioned all that happened to happen. Let me also say the following, that I am a great believer in the Constitution, and I will protect. I mean, many countries that have gone through what Kenya have gone through, Bangladesh, for example, they switched off the internet, they switched off the TVs, they did whatever they did. Kenya is running full steam. Internet is available every day. People are talking from all over the place. I mean, newspapers are writing whatever they want. The TV has four screens. They are showing what's happening in Kondele, what's happening is you in where? I mean, what further freedom, surely, would you ask from me? You know, I have the machinery to switch them off. I did not switch them off. Because I am a believer in the rule of law, and I am a believer in free media. You know, that's why the media can go out and demonstrate and call me names and do whatever they want. Doesn't bother me. But that is what freedom is about. That's what democracy is about. So I am very clear about what Katra has said. All you have said that has really come to me is the young people who were out there did not have colors of parties or regions or communities. They had Kenyan flags. And that is why I am committed to making sure that the interests of Kenya, even as I appoint the new administration, come first. What do we do about Kenya first? So that is what I wish to say. Asante sana. Yes, my friend.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. My name is John Jacob Kyoria from KBC. I want us to set the tone of this conversation, Mr. President. Mr. President, when the Gen Zs came out to the streets, their demand was that you overhaul the entire cabinet, which you did. You have defended the reappointment of 10 cabinet secretaries back to your cabinet. The big question Kenyans are asking today is President William Ruto a listening president? That is a big question tonight. Is President William Ruto a listening president?
Okay, I think there are too many media people asking. I think citizens want to ask this question. I think, let's just relax. I think the media have been asking me too many questions. Sasa raia nao wapate nafasi yao. Anyway, aya ngojeni kidogo. Ngojeni kidogo. Let me answer him anyway. Because Jacob has said something that is fundamental. Am I listening? Yes. How else would I have 12 of my cabinet secretaries out? If I wasn't listening, more than half of my cabinet have left. It has never happened in Kenya. It has never happened in Kenya's history that more than half the cabinet has gone in one go. So I am listening. And I have said, even the ladies and gentlemen that have come back to cabinet, they have come back to cabinet on new terms. We may have been friends, we may have been acquaintances, we may have, but now this is different. You know, we are going to work on the timelines the people of Kenya have given us. And some of the good gentlemen that I have and ladies that I have brought on board are people who have a proven track record. And many of them, Kenyans agree, have done a good job wherever they've been. Yes, let me listen to the lady. This side.
Hamjambo.
Jambo.
Kwa majina naitwa Mwanamkuu Nondo, mkazi wa Likoni sub-county. Mheshimiwa Rais, swala langu laja kwa upande wa feri. Feri ya Mtongwe. Sisi wananchi wa Likoni tupata shida sana pale feri wakati wa kuvuka. Sijui shida inatokea wapi kwa sababu wakati kulikuwa kuna bridge ya Liwatoni, likuwa kidogo kuna unafuu. Lakini tangu ile bridge iondolewe, tunapata tabu sana pale Likoni wakati wa kuvuka. Na shida sijui iko wapi kwa sababu hakuwa kulikuwa na feri ya Mtongwe ikifanya kazi na baadaye ilishia hivyo yani. Kwa hiyo naomba unijibu swala hilo langu. Shukran.
Sikusikia jina lako tafadhali.
Mwanamkuu Nondo.
Mwanamkuu Nondo.
Yeah.
Asante sana mwanamkuu.
Thank you.
Nitakujibu hivi. Just give me a minute. Let me answer Mwanamku, because it's a very important question. In fact, yesterday, when I stopped in Likoni, the people in Likoni asked me directly that question. And I didn't get it properly. It is later, because I answered a different question. It's good you have brought it into focus today. That bridge, we had built it. And it was a bridge, a pedestrian bridge for people to cross. It had two problems. Problem number one is that it caused a lot of delay in the port. The port, people said, it was taking more than 10 hours for ships to cross. That was problem number one. Problem number two is that the workmanship was not very good. So yesterday, after it was raised to me by the people in Likoni, I have instructed for both Kenha and KPA to get us a solution for that problem. So I will come back to you, Mwanamku, I will come back to you and to the people of Mombasa, and specifically the people from Likoni, on what it is that we are going to do to make sure that that bridge works. But let me also say this, just hold your horse. Let me also say this. There are two other things that we are doing. Shortly, we will open the connection of the bridge through Kibundani. In fact, I intend to come back here maybe in a month to make sure that that bridge is opened so that we can also have a different access from the other side going into Likoni and going into Kwale. And then thirdly, when I was in Japan earlier this year, we agreed with the Prime Minister of Japan to conclude the Mombasa Gateway Bridge. The Mombasa Gateway Bridge is going to sort out the problem of the ferry you have here in Likoni. We are now going to have a bridge the same way we have a bridge in Nyali. We are now going to have a bridge in, but it's going to be a different bridge because it has to allow ships to go through. We have agreed, we have signed the contracts to be able to have a modern, in fact, it will be the biggest piece of infrastructure in East Africa, because it's going to cost close to 100 billion shillings to build that Mombasa Gate Bridge. And I was with a Japanese ambassador yesterday, the day before, when I was in Kilifi, and we have agreed to have a session so that we can progress that discussion. So I have told you three things. I am looking at the pedestrian bridge. We are going to conclude the bridge through Kibundani, and we are well on the way constructing the Likoni bridge, the big bridge going into the future. Okay, let's get somebody from this side. Mama.
Asante sana. Mr. President, nina maswali mawili tu. Na nafurahi umegusia forex trading. Utaamini mama kama mimi ninafanya hiyo forex. Kama ungekuwa wote wanafanya forex, hakuna mtu angekuwa na kusumbua hapa. Ungekuwa tumetengeza more than $100 right now. Because I do boom and crash. So, nimepeleka hili somo kule vijijini mashinani. Vijana wana lack only smartphone na capital. Na wengine naendelea kuwafunza. Singependa kufa na hii knowledge bila hao kujua. So, le jambo la pili ni wazazi wenye watoto walemavu. Nimetembea mashinani, Mr. President. Ndoa zinavunjika kwa sababu ya hao watoto. Kwa sababu mtoto akionekana vile, mzazi wa kwanza kutoka ni baba. Mtoto anachiwa mama. Mtoto yule, labda ni wakubebwa, kuanikwa kwa jua, na kuregesha kwa nyumba. Ningependa hivi. Hizi shule zote za public, kama ungeruhusu, kila shule iwe na darasa, na vifaa, vya kufundisha wale watoto. Kwa sababu mtu anatoka Shanzu, mpaka Tononoka, ili mtoto apate elimu. Ukiangalia wamelala njaa, fare hakuna, hata ikiwezekana, kama unaweza kuwatolea magari ya kubeba wale watu wa disabilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Sikupata jina lako, pole. Elizabeth.
Kadzo.
Elizabeth Kadzo.
We were with you in Shanswood.
Ah, yeah. Uyu Elizabeth, ametaja mambo mawili ya muhimu. Jambo la kwanza, amesema yeye ni mfanyabiashara katika forex trading. Kwa wale ambao walikuwa wanafikiri ya kwamba pengine forex trading ni story, utamfuata huyo Elizabeth, atakueleza sio story, ni biashara. Na amesema tatizo kubwa ni mambo mawili, capital na smartphone. Ni nini tumefanya? Last year, tuko na kampuni mbili sasa Kenya, ambazo zinatengeneza smartphones in Kenya. Ile smartphone ilikuwa inauzwa 12,000, 15,000, sasa inapatikana kwa $40, which is like 5,000 shillings. Bado tunaisukuma chini. Katika finance bill ambayo ilianguka juzi, tulikuwa tumeondoa ushuru kwa smartphone. Ndio watu wengi waweze kufikia kununua smartphone kwa sababu ndio inaweza kuwasaidia kwa biashara. I am going to pursue, ama nitafuatilia, kuhakikisha kwamba we continuously reduce the cost of smartphones, ama kupunguza gharama ya smartphone, ndio vijana wengi, kina mama wengi, watu wengi waweze kufikia kununua, waweze kufanya biashara katika hali mbalimbali. Lakini nataka nikueleze pia Elizabeth ya kwamba pia tumebadilisha sheria. Sasa hawa vijana ambao hawana smartphone, hawa wabunge sasa kutakuwa na ICT hub kila ward. Na hiyo ICT hub itakuwa na free internet, itakuwa na free computer, itakuwa na mahali wanaweza kufanya hiyo biashara, including ya forest trading, vile hule jamaa nimekuambia Juma wa kule Kinango anafanya. So we are going to expand more opportunities for them to do that. Let me come to your second question. Issue umesema ni ya walemavu. Na ni kweli. Pale bado tuko na changamoto. Na ndio sababu nimefanya mambo mawili tangu niingie katika ofisi. Jambo la kwanza nimesema lazima tupanue ile mpango wa cash transfer ambayo inafikia watoto walemavu, watu wanaoishi katika wanaoishi na ulemavu, ndio tuweze tuwafikie wengi. Tumewasajili watu wengine wazee wa miaka ambayo 70 walemavu, tumewasajili wengine 1,500 in the last 1 year. Na tumewaweka sasa katika program ya cash transfer, number one. Number two, vile vile tumesema hiyo program ya cash transfer ilikuwa inachukua muda mrefu sana. Walikuwa wanangojea miezi 6, miezi 4 kabla hawajalipwa ile pesa ya cash transfer. Sasa tumebadilisha sheria, nilisema na nimetimiza ya kwamba kabla mshahara ya rais kulipwa, lazima cash transfer ilipwe. That is happening today. That is happening today. We are paying money for cash transfer for people living with disability, for the aged, and for orphans, at the same time as we pay salaries for public servants. They used to wait for 6 months, 4 months, 8 months. But as I made a commitment, I have kept that commitment. And people like the ones Elizabeth is talking about are going to be beneficiaries in that space. But I still agree with you on the third space. Ya kwamba, sio lazima watoto walemavu waende kwa shule ya watoto walemavu. We must make it possible for wale watoto wanaishi na ulemavu wasome pamoja na watoto wengine katika shule zetu zote. Na nilipata hiyo habari na umenisaidia, kwa sababu sasa leo nitafanya hiyo kazi umesema. Naamini watu wa wizara ya elimu wamo mahali fulani, nitawatafuta na nitawapatia amri ya kwamba what Elizabeth has said, because it is part of our manifesto, we were implementing it, lakini hatujaikamilisha. Sasa nitaifuatilia kwa kasi. Asante sana Elizabeth. Maybe somebody in front here one of these good people. Nani pale?
Thank you, Excellency. My name is Alawi Abzain. I come from the old town of Mombasa. Alawi Abzain. I've spent a better part of my life promoting heritage and culture. And in my travel around the world, I've seen that the old town or the oldest part of cities generate a lot of income. But unfortunately, when I look at the old town of Mombasa, which is actually the umbilical cord of Kenya. Everything in Kenya started in the old town of Mombasa. If we take a trip here and go and look at the old town of Zanzibar, the stone town of Zanzibar, it makes millions, millions and millions. Your Excellency, I'm using this opportunity to plead to you that the old town of Mombasa, we need to have an old town planning commission that will plan the old town and make it like the old city, let's say of Rome or Zanzibar, such that the government can be able to make like 5 billion just from the old town. Right now, it is the way it is. That is one. Two, I've seen for many years the previous administrations, they've been writing off loans for sugarcane, coffee, tea. We come from the coasts. Huyu mvuvi akiharibikiwa, mbona hatusikii serikali yetu ikisema chukua hii pole? Kwani sisi pia tunalipa tax? Kwa hivyo hili mimi linanihuzunisha sana. Kwa shauri, just like other Kenyans wakiharibikiwa, the other time tulikuwa tunaona 500 inapatiwa watu wa miraa. Sisi shamba letu ni Indian Ocean. Asante sana.
Asante sana mzee Alawi. Nakubaliana na wewe ya kwamba we can monetize our heritage. Nakubaliana na wewe kabisa ya kwamba heritage yetu kama ni pale old town and all the other heritage is something that we can monetize, and I'm sure my good friend Hersey, who is in the tourism sector, agrees that apart from our beaches, apart from our wildlife, there is more around culture, around food, around, you know, what makes Kenya what it is, that we can package to be able to get more tourists into Kenya. And I couldn't agree with you more, and I would want to conclude the forming of government, I would want to see what is it that we can discuss. How can we come up with a plan around Old Town? How do we incorporate other products? And maybe, Hersey, you will help me there to say something, because you are an expert in that space. But let me, before I ask you to say something there, let me say about blue economy. Alawi, let me tell you very clearly. I am very clear in my mind how important blue economy is to Kenya, not just to the people of the coast, but to Kenya. Today, we are unlocking about 20 billion shillings from the blue economy. The potential is 5-6 times more. My intention is that in the next 3 years, we should be making between 80 billion and 120 billion shillings from our blue economy resources. And that is why I have done 3 things on the blue economy. Number one, when I came into office, I changed the program that was there in the blue economy. There was a program funded by the World Bank that was focused on putting up buildings, holding seminars, holding workshops. I changed that program and I told our partners, I will not implement this program if it is not going to target what is important for the people of Kenya. Our development partners, and I must thank the World Bank, they agreed with me, and we changed that program. It is the program, Alawi, that brought me here on Friday. On Friday, I was at the showground here. At the showground, we gave out 1.7 billion shillings. Yeah? To 612 groups so that they can change their livelihoods. On Friday, I committed that we are going to buy 25 deep sea fishing boats. Because the boats we have at the moment, the ones we bought for our fishermen, about 120, cannot go very far. You can only go there for an hour or two or three. Now, we're going to buy another 25 fishing, deep sea fishing boats that can take a day or two into the deep sea to be able to get us the fish that we want for our country. And number three, for the first time in the history of Kenya, we have licensed an industrial fishing vessel flying the Kenyan flag for the first time that will do industrial fishing, one that can go for 1 month into the deep sea and get us tuna, and get us all the other fish. And by the way, that ship is going to be making about 4 billion shillings into Kenya every year, processing the fish here in Kenya, exporting the fish from here in Kenya. And my intention is to have 10 of those industrial fishing boats, minimum, by 2027. In fact, it is a conversation that I have already had with my friend Joho, and I have told him, this is the minimum I expect of you, God willing, when you are cleared by Parliament. Yeah? So that is what we are doing around the fishing space. We are putting the highest resources ever put in fishing and in the blue economy that any administration has put in that economy. So we are building 11 fish landing boats in Lake Victoria. We are building 5 fish landing ports here in sites here in the coast. We are putting one in Mwaepe, down in Kwale. We are putting one here in Mombasa. We are putting another one in Kilifi. We are putting one more in Lamu, and we are putting one in Kipini in Tana River. I have also put in resources to build the first national mariculture resource and training center so that we can equip our fishermen and women and people working in that space with the relevant skills and competences. We have trained 6,202 coxswains to be able to unlock the potential in our fishing space. I was in Kwale yesterday. We are building a 2.6 billion fishing port in Shimoni. So you agree with me, Alawi, that we are investing in the blue economy and we are not shortchanging the people of this region or shortchanging our blue economy ecosystem. Let me ask this good brother, maybe just to help me, my good friend Hersey. You want to say something about that space, my good friend Alawi was saying?
Thank you, Your Excellency, and welcome to Mombasa. You know, it's said that government world over, they're not very good in telling their story. And when they attempt to tell their story, people also don't believe them. So we are honored that you've invited us to address this and to answer, in fact, no censored questions, which to me is a great thing. And it just described the democracy we enjoy in this country, which we don't take for granted. So thank you very much, Your Excellency. You know, I sleep, I dream, tourism. And you're very passionate about creating jobs and employment for young men and women. Tourism is the easiest vehicle available to you and to your government in creating employment for our people. Kenyans are overall warm and friendly people. The other day I said, while other countries struggle with attitude issues, Kenyans, you don't have to teach them how to smile. It's natural. Kenyans and Swahili language is the only language that puts a foreigner and a guest on the same pedestal, and we call them wageni. We treat them well. We are looking at 2.5 million arrivals this year. And we struggled for a long time, Your Excellency, to hit even 2 million. Where I sit, and with my colleagues here, there is no reason why we cannot hit 3.5 million. We don't hit 4.5 million. And by the time we're hitting 2027, there's no reason why we should not even hit 5 million. No doubt. But Your Excellency, for us to do that, there are a few things that we need to do. And we call it the low-hanging fruits. No sweat. Very easy things. Number one is accessibility to our country. You know, international tourism, for them to get here, Kenya is considered a long-haul destination. Anything above 5 hours is a long haul. Morocco, Algeria, Egypt are considered short haul, which is 4-5 hours. Kenya and South Africa are sub-Saharan, so we hit 8 hours and above. Now, coming to air connectivity is a big challenge. But I must also commend our national carrier. I'm one of the critics of our national carrier. But let me also tell you, Your Excellency, the day we don't have a national carrier is the day we will be spending transit time in Dubai for 11 hours. Ethiopia will be holding us for 14 hours to connect to another country. But as long as they know we have an airline, they'll never mistreat us. And one thing also we don't know is that our national carrier, despite all its challenges, is the biggest source of passengers into Kenya. 60% of the people coming to Kenya actually come aboard KQ. In a single day, they have between 110 and 130 flights daily. All the rest put together don't even hit 45%. Now that takes me, before I come to the open skies, Your Excellency, please address the issues bedeviling our national carrier. We've been bailing them out year in, year out. But there are some fundamentals that need to be sorted out. As a national carrier, they are not given priority at our airports, both JKA and Moi International. When you go to Ethiopia, Ethiopian Airlines is given red carpet. BA is given red carpet at Heathrow, but KQ does not get that. Coming to open skies and specifically for Mombasa, and we've been fighting this for a long time, Your Excellency. 2007, 2008, we were getting 42 charters a week, but the charter business is dying. We now need to replace them with scheduled flights. The likes of Turkish, the likes of Qatar were flying into Mombasa, but after COVID, they were denied the license. And we are told we are trying to protect our national carrier. If Kenya Airways was flying to Istanbul, we would not be asking for a flight to Istanbul, Your Excellency. When you take an airline like Turkish Airlines, it's going to connect Mombasa to 18 cities in Germany alone. You take an airline like Qatar, it's going to take us to over 125 cities globally. That is direct to Mombasa. And we appreciate that you approved Fly Dubai to come into Mombasa. And that is one key thing that we need to do. Next is tourism investors. Your Excellency, good news is we have a lot of people who are willing to come and invest in Kenya today. Beach hotels. But guess what? Getting land is a nightmare. Getting land is a nightmare. When you go to Diani today, and you go from Indian Ocean Beach Club all the way to Galu, you'll find a lot of parcels of land that are still empty. 10 acres, 20 acres, 30 acres. Your Excellency, most of these guys were allotted this land at independence. They were allotted this land, second president when he came into power. Zanzibar next door will not allow you to sit on a piece of land for more than 3 years. You either develop it or you surrender it back to government and somebody takes it. So Your Excellency, as we sit now here, we have had investors who came here. They've disappointed and they've had to move elsewhere because getting land is just next to impossible. And when you get the price people are asking for, and yet they were allotted for free and they sat on it for 40 years and they didn't need nothing with it. So Your Excellency, that is something we really need to address. We've already brought it to the attention of Her Excellency the Governor, Kwale, and she's committed to address this. As we address that challenge, Your Excellency, another big challenge we're facing, because it's going to impact negatively on our efforts to create employment. Prime beach plots are being subdivided into quarter acres, into half acres. When you put 20 homes, the most you can do is employ a guard and a housemaid. That's it. When you take a 10-acre plot and you put up 150 rooms, you're looking at 300 young men and women who have been employed. And the taxes that go to government is big time as well. So those are issues that we'd like you to address. And then finally is the visa and ETA that you gave us. ETA, our plea is this, select countries, can you give them ETA on arrival? Thank you, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much, Hersey. I thought you were going to give me some credit that your hotels are between 80 and 90% full. Isn't that true?
That's why, Your Excellency, I said we are going to hit 2.5. We will even go to 3.5. We've done very well. And
thank you enough.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hersey. Just just allow me 1 minute to agree with my friend Hersey that we can say many things, but Kenya is going places. You may not want to agree with me. We moved the numbers in 2022, we were at 1.4 million arrivals. Last year, we went to between 2 million and 2 million and a bit. This year, we are going to hit 2.5, the highest arrivals in the history of Kenya. This year is going to happen. And it is because of the profile we have built. You know, many people accuse me, oh, you have been this place, you have been this place. I am the chief marketer of Kenya. You know, every place I go, I raise the profile of Kenya. Kenya is today respected globally. Kenya today, in any forum you go, they will say, what is Kenya saying? Right? So, and it's because of that what we are raising the profile of our country. I just wish everybody can do their bit so that we don't create instances where people begin to doubt what Kenya stands for. I am very confident that by 2027, 2028, the magical 5 million tourists, we will get there if we go with the trajectory we are going. And I will continue to push the limits for Kenya. I will continue to profile Kenya positively in a way that the world begins to think about Kenya. Number two, I agree with Hersey that already we have 42 countries where visa under the ETA program is automatic. When they apply, within 5 minutes, less than 5 minutes, they can travel to Kenya. Unlike before, where they had to look for the Kenyan embassy, go and queue for visa, do all manner of things. The next step, which Hersey is telling me, is that we need even to take it further and say, there are people who, even if you don't apply ETA wherever you are, if you arrive in Kenya, you can be given on arrival. That I agree with, and I'm going to work on it, so that we can build another layer of countries that to make it easier for people to come to Kenya. Just by changing the ETA, just by changing the visa regime, which I did in the last 6 months, we have 60% more people coming to Kenya today, just by making it easier for people to come to Kenya. Many people were asking me, why are you doing this? Oh, the country is going to be unsafe, and that kind of thing. I mean, we have made sure that there is sufficient checks and balances for us to make sure that Kenya is accessible. I agree with you that I need to do something about Kenya Airways. And I want to just relax, kidogo. Something needs to be done about Kenya Airways, and I am working hard at it. For your information, this year, it is the first year Kenya Airways made a profit. First year. And I still want to work on it, but I'm working on it so that we make sure that we straighten it and it can serve our country better. We still have a long way to go, and I'm still applying my mind to it. I agree with you that we need to approve a few more airlines. It's a delicate balance, people. It's a delicate balance between allowing more people to fly here, because anybody we allow to fly here, they must also give us an opportunity to fly to their destination so that it becomes even. So we are discussing with other airlines. We just approved another 4 flights by the UAE airline, Etihad. Yeah, the guard is here. We've just approved Etihad to fly 4 times a week. So we're looking at other opportunities for us to be able to get more flights. I've heard you about Turkish Airlines. We will look at it. My PS Dagar is there. Please, Turkish and Qatar. So we will look at it. But you know, there is something called in law quid pro quo. You scratch my back? Yes. Yeah. So we don't want just to do it. And let me say, give me a minute. Let me say this. It's true. Land is a problem in Kenya. It is the reason why real estate is very expensive in Kenya. And it is the reason why I decided that to be able to build affordable housing, we are going to use public land. That is why we have managed to reduce the prices significantly, because the land cost was contributing 40% of the cost of every house. But now when we take out the land cost, we substantially reduce and make it affordable for more Kenyans to be homeowners. We will need to think about what we are going to do so that we can make investment, especially on tourism infrastructure, much more affordable. By the way, I am doing something on some of our conference facilities in Bomas, here in Mombasa. We're trying to get investors to be able to support us in that space. And I'm also doing something, I'm also doing something about the airport. Let's be honest, Kenyans. Yani, the airport we have in Nairobi is made of canvas, in the middle of tarmac. That is the arrivals. I mean, this is a temporary structure we put up almost, 7 years ago. We don't, Ethiopia have a brand new airport. Rwanda have a brand new airport. And it is the reason why we need to work with investors to give us a new airport in Nairobi. I have seen many people saying, William Ruto wants to sell the airport. Am I a madman? You know, sure, how do you sell a strategic national asset? You have to be insane. You know? So we must have the right investment for the airport. The airport is a strategic government asset, national asset. What we want to do in the airport is to work under the PPP program. And people must understand, PPP has the potential, public-private partnership, has the potential to bring in private sector money, blend it with public sector investment to be able to create an outcome that brings win-win. Let me tell the people of Kenya, for example, let me give you an example. We are all celebrating the Nairobi Expressway. It nowadays takes 5 minutes, 10 minutes from the airport to Serena. True? Do you know that that Nairobi Expressway was not built with the government money? It was built by the private sector under the private-public partnership arrangement. You know? And that is the model that we are going to use to extend the superhighway from Nairobi to Nakuru to Eldoret to Malaba. That is what we are going to use to do many of our roads. That's what we want to do with our airport. We want to work with the private sector for them to do three things that are critical for our airport: to build a new terminal, to build a new runway, and to make sure that we refurbish what we have and remove the canvas. Ile hema iko hapo ambayo sasa ni arrivals. You know, it's a very shameful thing. The airport we built in 1970, I saw the plaque there, Jomo Kenyatta. That so many, almost 50 years ago. Now, the capacity was 7 million passengers. Last year, we had almost 9 million passengers. We are actually 10 years behind schedule in modernizing our airport. Other countries are ahead of us. I want to persuade us as Kenyans, let us not buy into fake news. Let us not buy into propaganda. There is no government that can sell a national asset, a strategic national asset like the airport. We are going to work in an open and transparent manner to make sure that we develop the airport using legal instruments that can be audited by Parliament and by other agencies to make sure that they bring value to the people of Kenya. So the same thing that Hersi is saying, to develop the infrastructure here. We do not have sufficient conferencing facilities. The KICC we have in Nairobi was built through Arambe, imagine, by KANU, those days. Then it was taken over by government. It is now 50 years old. We need a modern conferencing facility if Kenya is truly going to be a hub for tourism. We need one in Nairobi, we need one in Mombasa, and that's why we are working with the Mombasa, former Mombasa resort here, to see how we can get investors to be able to develop new conferencing facilities. Okay. There is a lady there in uniform, some very nice uniform.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. President. My name is Lucy Wamaitha Machugu, the Vice President, Kenyatta University, and I want to represent all students in the universities in Kenya, because actually we were on the streets and we would wish to inquire some answers from you. First is to appreciate the government and the Ministry of Education, because you've set an event on the 9th of August at KICD for all the student leaders and all the students to discuss on the funding model. So some of the questions I would wish to inquire answers from you, Mr. President. Number one, why did you come up with the funding model? How does the funding model work? Do you feel like the implementation of the funding is okay? What is the criteria used to group people to different categories? That is about the funding model. Number two, the accommodation prices in the universities, that is the hostel prices. They are very expensive for us to afford. Mr. President, what are you doing about this? We cannot be able to afford houses or hostels where we are living in universities. What are you doing, Mr. President, about this? Something else about the job opportunities. Once we graduate from the university, we are told, maybe when you go and seek for a job opportunity, we are asked to give a 5-year work experience or a 3-year work experience. Yet, we've just graduated. Where will we get the experience from if you are not given the chance to get the experience? So, Mr. President, how can you help us on that? Lastly, Mr. President, what are you doing to re-engineer the National Youth Council? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lucy. And by the way, you are very smart. Now, let me say, you've asked me two fundamental questions. The new university's funding model, why? Very important question, why? When I came into office, the universities were struggling. They had a 60 billion shilling debt. Many universities were paying their lecturers half the price, half the salary. It was near a crisis. And many vice chancellors agree with me. So it became necessary. And you know, I have a history. Once upon a time, I was Minister for Higher Education. So I understand that space pretty well. And when I came into office then as Minister for Higher Education, I am the one who developed and created the space around our TVETs, because there was a missing gap in our education system. I am very proud that today our TVETs are a big portion of our higher education learning infrastructure. Let me go back to the funding model. The funding model, by the way, affects both our university students and also affects our TVET students. So what did I do? I did three things. Number one, we made a commitment as government that we are going to give every student 80% scholarship and loan. But because we could not afford, especially because the number of students, when we made that commitment, it was like 15 years ago. But you know, as the numbers increased in the university, it became difficult for us to meet that commitment. And so what ended up happening was that while we committed to pay 80%, we ended up paying 50%, some cases 45%. So what happened? There was a huge funding cut in our universities, a huge funding gap in our universities. And our universities were struggling. They couldn't pay for services, they couldn't pay lecturers, they couldn't run their programs, and we ended up with affecting the quality of education in our universities. You couldn't attend as many labs as was required, you couldn't attend as many practicals as you required. We ended up compromising on our education. So what did I do? I said, we need to be honest with ourselves. And we said, there are parents like William Ruto who can afford. Why would William Ruto be given 80%? Why would the child of William Ruto be given 80% scholarship? The same as a child of Mama Mboga. What happens is that both our children end up suffering. So we changed the model. We said, since there is a means testing instrument that has been used for 20 years to assess every student on the basis of the information they supply, and it has worked in Kenya for 20 years, let us use that means testing instrument that is available at the Higher Education Loans Board to assess every student. And we changed the model so that children from vulnerable families, children from parents who are less endowed, we move them from getting 80% to getting 95%. And children from parents like myself, we move them from getting 80%, we move them to 60%. Because we can afford, right? So we had five categories. We changed it into five categories. And you know what, Lucy? Because of the change in that model, we also said that scholarship is going to be available on application. Because, you know, the old model, every student, without even applying, they were given scholarship. But there are parents who do not need it. And for your information, 20% of students last year did not apply for scholarship. They went and their parents paid because they didn't need it. What has happened? Of that 20% of the students, we now have more money to pay for children from vulnerable families. That is how the model has changed. So we now have five categories. We have those that get 95%, we have those that get 90, we have those that get 70, we have those that get 60, and we have categorized, and we are using what we are calling an instrument called means testing instrument that tests the ability of parents. We will continue to perfect. We'll continue to perfect that instrument. There will always be maybe a problem here and there, but we will make sure that we keep that program so that we increase the level of funding in our universities. What has happened? Because of this new funding model, we have had to increase money that we are putting in the education of our university students from about 45 billion. This year, we put 82 billion shillings. We are putting more money because we have to be realistic. We cannot send our kids to school and we haven't provided for funding for them to go and be taught. We would be cheating our children if we tell them go to school and we cannot pay the lecturers in school, we cannot pay for their classes, we cannot run the programs. So that is why I have decided I am spending more money in education. It's much more expensive for me, but it is better to have students who graduate when they have gone through proper school, with proper learning, with their parents, with their teachers paid and their lecturers paid, and we have increased the budget for education in that manner. Number two, I know there is a problem, and the problem is a problem of communication, because many parents received an admission and they saw there the course costs 300,000. Then the parents said, okay, where am I going to find these 300,000? I have since instructed the ministry that although the cost is 300,000, there must be clarity that this course is 300,000, yes, but a parent can get up to 95% scholarship and loan of that amount. So I think now there is going to be greater communication so that parents can understand that whatever it is that is appearing on those admission letters is not the money demanded from them. It is just the cost of the course. But that course will be met largely by scholarship, partly by loan, and very insignificantly by parents paying the fee they have been paying. I have told you why. It is work in progress. This is the first year we are implementing. I know there are still teething problems, but we will want to work with student leaders like you, Lucy, and others, so that we can properly explain. And I really want to invite student leaders from university. I am prepared to engage with them. I am ready to engage with them because I am doing what is best for all our university education. I am very passionate about education, and it is the greatest equalizer. It is the reason why I decided to hire 56,000 new teachers, because I believe education is the greatest equalizer and no child should be locked out from education. Hostels. Lucy has said, and I agree with you, I have been to many parts of Kenya, and students live in squalor. They live in very bad conditions. They live sometimes in slums, and they live in very dangerous places. And that is why I have made the decision that we are going to work with our Ministry of Housing. We are going to leverage on our housing fund to support our hostels in our universities. I came from Taita Taveta today. I made an announcement in Taita Taveta that Taita Taveta University, we're going to build 1,500 hostels. Oh, the Mr. President, now you can take it to your students. So we are going to have, and they will pay for them, but they will pay a reasonable amount, not the amount that you are now paying in very complicated neighborhoods. And we're going to do that for our TVETs, we're going to do that for our universities, so that our university students can live in decent neighborhoods. I was, for example, in Alupe University in Busia last year, and the students were living miles away. I was in Bukura Technical Training College, and the students were asking me to put lights because they were living in a very far place, and sometimes at night when they go late, they were being mugged along the way. So we are also providing infrastructure for hostels in all our universities going forward. It's going to be progressive. We can't build all of them at the same time, but the journey is going to start so that we can deal with that challenge. And you have helped me answer the question about education. Somebody had asked me, my good friend, the first gentleman who had asked a question there. Okay? I am reminded, just hold on. I am reminded that by my good staff that Kenya Airways made an operating profit, not a net profit. Something between net and operating, somewhere around there. But things are moving in the right direction. That's what I was just trying to say. I am told there are people behind me here who have not said anything. Okay, my friend, let me start with this young man. You can use my mic.
Thank you, sir. I'm privileged. I am the president of Lamu Universities and Colleges Student Association. Yes, I'm from Peketoni. And I've been sent here, sir, with a question. Back in 2nd of March, 2012, yeah, I was very young. His Excellency, the former president, Hayati Mzee Mwai Kibaki, launched the Lamu Port, the Lapset Corridor. And he gave out an affirmative action that 1,000 youth should be schooled, should be taken to college, and empowered to work in the port. But since then, only 400 got the chance to get the scholarship to college and to be empowered to run the program in the port. Now the question is here. The remaining 600. The other day we saw that the fisheries were compensated. What about the educational sector? What about the bursary that remained of the 600, sir. The comrades are really complaining on that. Thank you, sir.
Okay. I didn't get your name.
I'm sorry. I'm Kabao Clinton. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Clinton. Now, yes, I agree with you. The government of Kenya made a commitment that because of the situation in Lamu, and I have had a conversation with the Honorable Rueda, the Member of Parliament from Lamu East, and the Honorable Mudhama, the Member of Parliament from Lamu East, including the Governor, and on this very subject of Lamu. And I also made my personal commitment that I am going to sponsor, as a person, 300 students to go to TVET in Lamu East. I was reminded yesterday by the Member of Parliament, Rueda, that she's doing her part, and I have asked her to give me the invoice for my part. But we made a commitment, the government of Kenya made a commitment, Clinton, on what to do with Lamu. The progress in Lamu has not been fast enough. We have the first three baths now working. We are trying to get the rest, investment for the rest to be done. We've just done the road. When I came into office, I decided to upgrade the road from Lamu that had been built to Maram standard. I decided to upgrade it to Tamak from Lamu all the way to Garissa so that we can connect it to the bigger corridor going to Ethiopia. And the expansion and the operationalization of that port is what is delaying. But Clinton, I want to give you my assurance that we will not renege on the commitment that was made by the government of Kenya. As soon as we can see activity in the port, we will unlock all the other opportunities for the 600 students to be trained in port logistics and all the other courses that are necessary for the operationalization of the port. And you will be happy to know that we are actually building here in Matuga. We are building a port logistics and infrastructure college that will train many people on port logistics and all the other things that are required in the port. And maybe students from Lamu may become beneficiaries, may actually become the first students in this college. But I want to give you my assurance, Clinton, that we are going to make that commitment. Yes, let me have one more lady. I think the men have spoken somewhere, maybe on this side. Give a lady there. Na vijana. Aya, mama alafu kijana.
Kwa majina naitwa Stella Wandoe, director wa Inua Mama Mashinani, Jenga Taifa. Your Excellency, karibu kwanza Mombasa. Na pia tunashukuru kwa yale ambayo unaendelea kufanya. Swali langu ni kwamba umeanza kutengeneza masuala ya affordable houses. Na hapa kwetu Mombasa, kama vile umetamka kwamba Nyali kutakuwa na ujenzi kama huu ambao utaendelea. Swali langu likuendee kwako. Kuna kina mama ambao wako hapa Mashinani. Na mama hawa wamepitia changamoto nyingi sana hivi kwamba wanashindwa ku access government opportunities. Na wana kampuni ambazo wameregister. Na ungependa hata kuchangia katika hizi kazi ambazo ziko pale mkandarasi anapokuwa amepewa. Swali langu ni kwamba hawa mama watasaidika vipi hivi kwamba mkandarasi anapoingia kwa site. Hawa mama pia tunaomba kwamba waweze kupewa kipaumbele. Kuna masuala ya supplies, kuna masuala mengi ambayo yangewasaidia hapa Mashinani. Na ukikumbuka kwamba mama huyu ni mama ambaye ni mama wa chini, na mara nyingi hawa mama wa chini wameachwa kando sana kwa sababu yanapohusu kibiashara. Kwa hivyo masuala ya biashara ambayo ipo kwa sasa ni maswala ambayo hii yenye umeleta affordable houses, na ni kana kwamba ni vijana tu peke yake ambao wana access, lakini hawa mama imekuwa changamoto kwao. Kwa hivyo Mheshimiwa Rais, tunaomba kwamba utukumbuke.
Asante.
Pili, tulisign, kwa mfano kama mimi nilisign charter, na nilisign na wewe charter Mheshimiwa Rais. Hii women's charter tunapaswa kuitekeleza hapa mashinani. Nafikiri utakuwa na mpango, naomba utakuwa na mpango ambao unaweza saidia hawa mama tuweze kueleza namna hii charter ilikuwa ifanye kazi vipi. Unajua mama mashinani lazima waelezewe ndio apate kuelewa.
Asante
sana Mheshimiwa.
Thank you mama. Vile umesema mambo ya affordable housing, na umesema ya kwamba government opportunities kwa kina mama. Nilikuwa juzi nikifungua huduma center. Nafikiri nilikuwa Tharaka Nithi. Na sijui nilifungua huduma center tena mahali pengine. Na pale katika huduma center tumeweka desk ya access to government opportunities, the ACBO program, ambayo ni ya vijana na kina mama waweze kujua ni vipi wanaweza kujumuishwa katika biashara ya serikali. Ningekuuliza mama Stella kwamba katika harakati za kina mama waweze kuelewa ya kwamba wako na nafasi ya 30% ya biashara za serikali, lakini kila mama lazima ajitokeze. Nimefurahi ya kwamba umesema kuna mama tayari wameregister makampuni. Nilikuwa mahali jana Diani, nilikuwa Diani jana pale Kinondo. Kuna wamama pale, nilifurahi sana kwa sababu niliambiwa hawa kina mama ndio wamesajiliwa, wako na makampuni. And in fact jana nilianzisha soko pale Ukunda. Nilianzisha soko ambayo kandarasi hiyo ni ya mama mwenyewe, ndio yule ambaye amepata hiyo kandarasi ya milioni 200 kujenga soko jana pale pale Ukunda. And I was very proud. Nilifurahi sana wakati nilijua ya kwamba kina mama wamejitokeza, na sio tu kutafuta ile biashara ya 1200, 1500, milioni 2. Sasa kina mama ndio wamesonga, sasa ndio walikuwa najenga hiyo soko. Na niliambia yule ambaye anasimamia, waziri wangu Alice Wahome, ambaye tena nimemteua asimamie sekta hiyo, na pia yule principal secretary wetu, ya kwamba kina mama wapewe nafasi hasa katika programs ambazo za ujenzi, kwa sababu tunajua ya kwamba what men can do, women I'm told can do better. They can do better. So kuna hizo nafasi, lakini najua ya kwamba hazijakuwa za kutosha. Vile vile umesema kuhusu mambo ya affordable housing. Affordable housing ni program ambayo itampatia mama ule hata wa chini. Unajua watu wengi wananiuliza, wewe bwana ulizungumzia sana mambo ya mama mboga, lakini hatuoni mama mboga kwa program zako. Wacha ni wajibu hivi. Kwanza tunajenga soko 400 Kenya ya wakina mama mboga, 400 markets across Kenya. Jana peke yake nilifungua soko pale, nilianzisha soko pale pale Kinondo, pale Ukunda. Kuna county aggregation and industrial market pale Zombo, kule Lungalunga. Weekend hii peke yake nimeanzisha soko 4, na tuko na soko 200 tayari tumepatiana kandarasi, na mpango yetu itatufikisha soko 400, the largest infrastructure for women in Kenya to do business. Number 2, katika hii program ya affordable housing itawezekana kwa mama mboga kununua nyumba kwa hiyo program, jambo ambalo halingewezekana kwa sababu mama mboga anaweza kulipa shilingi 1,300 na apate nyumba na hiyo nyumba ikue yake. Number three, nimeweka program ile ya universal health coverage ambaye pia itampatia nafasi mama mboga aweze kuwa na bima ya afya. Kila mmoja wetu ajisajili and we are going to make sure that even women in our markets can have access to universal health coverage and they too can be members of the social health insurance fund. Either they pay between 200 and 300 shillings or those who cannot afford, the government of Kenya will pay for them. So in my mind, I have kept Mama Mboga as part of my plan. Ah, naambiwa ya kwamba muda umetupa kizogo. Hiyo Kiswahili sijui nimeishika vizuri. Aya, tupatie vijana. Haya, kuna mama na ni kijana hapa. Amelete fujo kweli huyu mama. Mpatie microphone. Ai.
Hey, President, ungeenda bila kunipa mic bwana. Aya, kwa majina naitwa Aisha Mohamed na natoka Kisauni. Swali langu ni lile ambalo limeulizwa na dada pale kuhusu National Youth Council, Madam President. National Youth Council was established in 2009. To date, we have seen little progress on that particular institution. And why, Mr. President? I'll give you two things. One, because of lack of political goodwill and goodwill from your side. And the second one is because of hakuna pesa kwa National Youth Council. Budget yao ko less than 100 million, Mr. President. And I want this to be part and parcel of your own dream thing that you'd want to do. How do we ensure that we reignite National Youth Council? Elections and National Youth Council zifanyike. Utupe timelines, Mr. President, because as young people, that is our institution. That is where our voice is at. And if that voice is voiceless, then we don't have a voice, Mr. President. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Aisha. I can see why you wanted the microphone. You are very passionate about it. I think Lucy has also, from the universities, had asked me. I think the issue we have had with the National Youth Council is that many people see it as a government thing. We need to divorce it from being a government thing so that it becomes a youth, you know, a youth council, and let the youth have a final say, without the government influencing what the youth want to do, or politicians influencing the outcome of the youth elections. I am open to ideas on how we can reconfigure the youth council. And I really want young people to tell me how they want it done. I am ready to spearhead. So I don't know how we're going to do this together. Maybe I will ask some of our university students to provide leadership, maybe have an engagement with me, maybe in the course of the next 2-3 weeks, and then we agree on how we are going to set up that youth council, not to be the preserve of university students, but to just collect ideas from them. And then we see how youth from all levels, including the Mashinani youth, can become part of that. And let me give you, you told me, let me give you, I must give you timelines. Hey, Aisha, umenikasa sana. Hey. Aya. Okay, okay, Aisha. So, my staff, do I have somebody from my office who can take it up? Mohammed, will you take that up? So that in the next 3 weeks we have a meeting of the young people, and then they tell me how they want to take this this forward. Finally, let me give to this good girl, Sandy Sana. Yes.
My name is Leila Sharif. Asante sana Rais kwa kufika Mombasa. Leila Sharif. Swali langu ni kwamba hapa Mombasa tuko na stadium, Mombasa Municipal Stadium, ambayo miaka nyingi haya operate.
na kuna mashule mengi. Kuna mashule mengi, we have special events every year from different schools, primary and secondary. And it's a special place for Mombasa people. It's one of the biggest stadiums. So if we can have you and tell us, when can we have this stadium constructed and ready, inshallah, for the youth and the children, because this also keeps our youth busy and ni mahali ya mazoezi, watakuwa pia less in other things that are not good. Thank you.
Okay, there's another girl here who wants to say something.
Thank you. Karibu sana Mombasa, Mr. President. Kwa majina naitwa Ramla Nasib, ni mkazi wa Kisauni. Ramla.
Ramla.
Yes. Sasa, sisi kama vijana, tumekuwa tukitafuta kazi. Kuna wenzangu wengi wametaja kuhusu lack of employment to youth. So, katika civil servants, most of them, from my observation, that is ni wazee ama ni watu wazima. Alafu sasa, from huyu kijana kitambaja apate kazi katika yu civil servant, maybe amekuwa mzee. So, how about we introduce an early retirement to the civil servants so that sisi vijana tuweze ku-experience, tuweze kupata nafasi hapo kwa gava, ndo tuweze ku-experience kwamba how the government tests, you know? That is one. Two, kuna job security pia haiko sawa in Mombasa and any other part of Kenya. Na pia vijana, wengi wetu tumesoma, but it took us years to graduate simply because hakuna pesa za kusoma. You see, tume struggle for us to reach where we are. And then, ukifika hapo mahali umegraduate, you have that degree, unakuta kwamba hauna kazi. So you've been struggling all your years to graduate, and now you're struggling to get into that job security. Sasa, sisi kama vijana, I'll say, I personally am traumatized. Kwa sababu kila nikikaa, nafikiria vile nili struggle kumaliza shule. And now I'm really struggling kupata kazi, niseme kwamba, yes, my mom had done something, so lazima apate appreciation, you know. So how about you introduce maybe support centers, is maybe psychological support centers where watoto kama sisi wenye tuko traumatized in that line of work tuweze kupata support, you know? Yes, from the experts. Sawa. Thank you.
Sawa, Ramla. And sawa, Leila. Let me start with Leila. Leila, ameniuliza kuhusu stadium ya Mombasa. Tulikuwa na mpango ya stadium ambazo tumejenga different parts of Kenya. Watu walikuwa na ni-accuse sana kwamba hizo stadium hazikuwa zimekamilika. Sasa tumekamilisha zote. Sasa ile imebaki sasa, hii ya Mombasa ilikuwa na matatizo. Kwa sababu kulikuwa na kutoelewana kati ya national government na county government ya Mombasa. Lakini sasa tumepata maelewano. Na tunapanga sasa, badala ya kujenga stadium ndogo, tumesema kwa sababu Mombasa ndio city yetu ya pili kubwa Kenya, tujenge stadium yenye iko kiwango ya juu kidogo, sio kama zile zingine. Kwa sasa concentration yetu iko katika kukamilisha stadium ine ambazo tutatumia kwa AFCON. Nyinyi mnajua Kenya, Uganda na Tanzania tulishinda hosting ya AFCON in 2027. Kwa hivyo concentration yetu kwa sasa, we want to complete the four stadia that will be used by AFCON. That is where we are committing most of our resources. Lakini Leila amesema, after we look at the completion of those four, Mombasa, we have already assessed, maybe we are going to build a bigger stadium in Shanzu or in a place where we'll agree with the county government of Mombasa. So, Leila, it's in our plan. Na nakubaliana na wewe itasaidia vijana wa Mombasa. Ramla amesema ya kwamba vijana wengi wanafanya bidii, wanamaliza shule. Alafu, kumaliza shule na bidii yote, tena inatokea shida ya ajira. And it is the reason, ndio sababu Ramla, umesikia nikisema hapa, na nimeongea kwa kirefu, kwamba ni kweli. Kwanza mimi, kazi yangu ya kwanza, ni kuchaguliwa mjumbe. Nilipata mshahara, the first salary I ever got. You know, I just struggled like many of you who did not get a job. So, I know what it means not to have a job. Na ndio nataka ni kueleza ya kwamba, ndio sababu unaona nafanya bidii kuhakikisha kwamba kuna mipango ambayo itapatia ajira vijana wa Kenya. Ramla, nataka ujue hivi. Haitawezekana kwa serikali ya Kenya kuajiri watu wote. In fact, it's not possible for government of Kenya to hire people. We can only hire teachers, doctors, accountants, watu wafanyikazi wa serikali, lakini wachache. Watu wengi ni serikali kutengeneza hali ambapo itatusaidia makampuni, viwanda, yale vitengo mbalimbali watupatie nafasi za ajira. Na ndio sababu unaona ninafanya bidii kuhakikisha kwamba kuna programs za serikali, vile nimesema housing. Kwa mfano, ukiona gazeti ya juzi, last week, tulikuwa na nafasi 4,000 za kazi katika program yetu ya housing. Hizo nafasi 4,000 ni za professionals, wale wa kutoka TVET, wale wa kutoka university, watu ambao ni QSS, watu ambao ni architects, watu ambao ni engineers, different categories in that space. Kulikuwa na nafasi hizo kwa serikali, lakini watu wengi wataajiriwa na makampuni. Na ndio sababu tunafanya bidii kuhakikisha kwamba kuna hali ambapo kampuni nyingi zinaweza kuegeza katika Kenya. Wakiegeza Kenya, ndio wataajiri wa Kenya wengi. Ndio unaona tunafanya bidii kuzuia yale products ambazo zinatoka nchi zingine, ili tusitengeneze na kampuni za Kenya. Kwa sababu kampuni za Kenya zitaajiri wa Kenya. Ndio unaona tunafanya bidii in those, all those areas nimetaja hapa. Digital space, export of labor, housing, program on industrialization, program on export processing zones, so that we can create more jobs for people like you. But I agree with you, maybe we need to think about also assisting those who have challenges, psychological challenges, and see what the government can do. It is something that I will take home from here, that there is something that I need to do about people maybe who have been in that space for long, and maybe they are affected in one way or another. How do we assist? How do we assist them? That is homework you have given to me. I will go and think about it. So, Ramla, very good. So, na amesema ya kwamba wale watu wamekaa huko kwa serikali wa watembe. Unajua sasa sheria ya Kenya inasema miaka 60. Na nimetangaza juzi ya kwamba wale wote wamefikisha miaka 60 wafanye hivyo. Si ndio? I don't know tutaweza ku create nafasi ngapi. Niliona watu wengine wakisema nafasi 30,000 sijui, lakini kama zitapatikana hizo 30,000 basi ndio vijana pia watajipanga kule ndani. Kwa hivyo, ndugu zangu watu wa Mombasa, hii ndio ilikuwa nafasi ya kwanza mimi kuwa na mazungumzo ya moja kwa moja, ana kwa ana, na Wakenya. Muniulize maswali na mimi nijibu. Hii sio mwisho. Hii ndio mwanzo. Na nitafanya hivi kwa mpango. Nitaona kama nitaweza kufanya kila mwezi ama kila baada ya wiki mbili. Nitazungumza na Wakenya kutoka sehemu mbalimbali. Leo nimefurahi sana kupata nafasi kuongea na ndugu zetu wa kutoka hapa Pwani katika mazungumzo haya. I want to say to all of you who interacted with me, asked questions, to tell you I am truly grateful and I'm very proud that we can have this conversation as Kenya and as Kenyans. And wacha ni watetee wale wanahabari ambao walikuwa hapa pia wakauliza maswali. Nafikiri wamenizoea sana kuniuliza maswali mpaka wengine wakasema hapana. Wacha tupate Wakenya wengine pia waulize huyu bwana maswali. So asanteni sana. Nataka ni washukuru nyote kwa maswali yenu. Every question you have asked is important to us. And it is important that the people of Kenya hold me to account. Because that is the responsibility that I have as President of Kenya. So that I can be able to be answerable to the people. Asanteni sana, Mungu awabariki, na nawapenda sana. Thank you very much, God bless you.